What franchise was milked is being milked too much? Not gonna lie, I watched A Fairly Odd Summer just to see how they ruined it, and it ended up being my favorite movie of 2020. It's genuinely fun in a campy, bad movie way. Trent Norris, voice actor for Timmy Turner's dad, is funny as always. Seeing Crocker's classic fairy godparents freak out in live action was absolutely amazing, and the twist end is perfect. I'm looking at this with adult eyes and I hate it. But it's not for adults, obviously, it's for kids. I think we all forget how dumb some of the stuff we watched as kids was. We didn't see it as dumb then, so our brains didn't store it in our memories as being dumb, and that's just the shows we remember. I hate hearing people complain about how cartoons, kids' shows nowadays are all terrible. Like, no, there have always been dumb shows. You are just older and don't think the dumb ones are funny anymore. There has always has been and currently is a mix of dumb shows for young kids who will laugh at dumb shit and shows with more clever humor. If there's one thing I'm thankful for about that movie is at least they are very clear that Drake Bell is playing an adult Timmy and not a full-grown-ass adult playing a 10-year-old. That'd be very creepy. Yep. They're doing a live-action one now. Think at least the voice of Cosmo is the same, but not sure about anything else. The movies had Drake Bell as Timmy, but I don't suspect he'll be returning due to the most recent development. Edit, since I was annoyingly vague. The recent developments are that Drake Bell was convicted of sexually abusing a 15-year-old. 4 years ago, he received 2 years probation. I hope that is enough detail for the guy that felt it necessary to be annoyingly an asshole. That's where I stopped as well. Not out of anger or upset, just was the first time a show changed, and I realized I was no longer interested, not the target audience anymore. My gripes with the show have nothing to do with the show itself. I think the show should end to make room for new stuff. Nickelodeon needs to leave the zeros. What have they done in the last 10 years that was noteworthy? Kara? That they pushed to the side. Cartoons are such a great medium. It's a shame to see an entire network sleep so hard. Yep, they're doing a live-action one now. Think at least the voice of Cosmo is the same, but not sure about anything else. The movies had Drake Bell as Timmy, but I don't suspect he'll be returning due to the most recent development. Edit, since I was annoyingly vague. The recent developments are that Drake Bell was convicted of sexually abusing a 15-year-old. 4 years ago, he received 2 years probation. I hope that is enough detail for the guy that felt it necessary to be annoyingly an asshole. That's true. I like a lot of those too. I guess my brain just lumps them together, and I remember the muffin one as my finale, regardless of chronological order. I have a very clear memory of dancing with my elementary school best friend in her living room and shouting Jimmy Timmy Power Hour every single time the commercial came on the day of the premiere. So I think you're right. It's just those live-action ones that are trash. I still didn't watch much after Poof came though. The animated movies aren't bad. There's a few of them, basically just longer themes episodes. One of my favorites is Channel Surfers, I think it's called, where Timmy goes through all the TV channels chasing Vicky with their magical remotes. Person above may have been talking just about the live action movies, which were pretty freaking terrible and absolutely unnecessary. Truly nobody asked for all that lol. Yes. The Sharknado movies are absurd and stupid, but they know that, and are leaning into it. Granted, I've only seen the first two, but I think they're a cool idea, because the movies are winking at the audience. This is not The Asylum, which are just making mockbusters that are low-effort rip-offs, but a different beast, one that is deliberately bad, but in a funny way. Six is probably too many, but I approve of the concept. I've never met someone who wasn't me to bring up that scene. I remember the first time I saw it, it fucking killed me in that evening. A little while into getting frisky with my partner, it just came into my brain and I couldn't stop myself from saying it. I said, "Hey, remember that baby shark birth? Fucked up him thinking about that now, huh?" Let's just say we needed an 15-minute laughing break because of my immaculate timing. You know why? There is literally nothing in the entire world like that one sentence you just said. The studies show that your mind remembers unique things better than things that happen over and over. That's why they say time flies faster when you're older, because less things are new to you and you just don't remember as much about each specific day, moment that things happen. So you remember that sequence so well, because what in the actual fuck is like a shark eating a pregnant woman in space, plummeting to Earth, then getting cut open from the inside by the woman who it ate, who also gave birth inside a shark? If you enjoy it, and it doesn't hurt anybody else, there should be no guilt. That's how I like to look at it. Anyway, I used to be unnecessarily judgy about someone's outward appearance if it was too loud, like pink hair and a bunch of piercings or whatever. But like who gives a shit? They're not hurting anyone looking like that. And the same could be said about a lot of things, as long as it doesn't directly impact someone in a negative way. Highlight of the whole series was in 3 or 4 when heavily pregnant Tara Reid was eaten by a shark in space. The offending shark crash landed on Earth. Everyone was like, "Oh shit, Tara's dead." Then Tara Reid cuts a hole in the side of the shark and pushes her newborn baby she birthed inside the shark out of the hole. There are meaningful life events I have very hazy recollection of, yet I remember this clear as yesterday. That's sadly because they drop the whiners afterwards. They give them a recording contract and send them on their way, as if getting a record deal would be enough to make people successful. Also, they stack seasons one over the other, so they're not even finished hearing one that they're already recording the auditions for the next one. They're not even letting people breathe. It's almost as if they just want you to focus on the current season and forget everything else. I remember Christina complained that they were just part of a money-making machine and the producers didn't care about the singers at all. The focus of these shows is now the judges, not the performers. Fuck, I hate that. My parents totally love this and it's absolutely about the judges. Only thing that matters is whose team anyone is on, and coach drama. And then the coaches are probably told by production to pick 2 people for each genre they do well with, so the showdown round can be exciting and make sense. So no matter how many country singers get turns, I'm pretty sure Blake can only select 2 or 4 at most, even though he's the country guy on that panel. It's just a talent show that started after the talent show format had already morphed into its current form. The focus of these shows is now the judges, not the performers. They don't even disguise that fact. Just look at how they're edited. How many times per performance is there a cutaway to show a judge reacting or discussing something with another judge? Yeah, I think people probably feel like they know the judges better. I'll be honest, the blind auditions are kind of cool, if for nothing else to see the judge's reaction. Though I think if it was blind for the audience too, it would be cooler, but then you don't get the backstories they love. Problem is, IRL, the music industry isn't blind. For every Adele and Lizzo, there are tons of very talented women and men who aren't aesthetically pleasing enough to get the record contracts. I wish I wasn't guilty of this, but I am, even toward guys. I remember seeing a picture of the guy who sang "Someone You Loved" and I was like, really? That's what this guy looks like. These performers are probably trapped in hellish contracts that prevent them from releasing music on their own or through other labels once the label they won a contract with loses interest in them and stops promoting and recording them. the talent shows are more interested in the ratings and longevity of the show itself, not the long-term careers of any of the contestants who all felt pressured to sign a terrible contract with no legal advice or negotiation power because thousands of other starry-eyed competitors are lined up behind them also wanting their shot at fame. I think it's because The Voice has much more of a focus on the coaches rather than the singers themselves. American Idol let the contestants have a bit more agency and showcase their personalities to a larger extent, which I'm sure drove future commercial success for them. American Idol was also only a once-a-week show and on a certain portion of the year, spring I think. Where if I just leave the TV on NBC on a random weekday evening at any point in the year, one think there's a 25% chance a new episode of The Voice will be on. The care factor for audiences just isn't there due to oversaturation. As an aside, the record deal you get for winning is crap. It's much better for you as an artist to come in top 5 and go it on your own as far as the terms go. It's just a talent show that started after the talent show format had already morphed into its current form. The focus of these shows is now the judges, not the performers. They don't even disguise that fact. Just look at how they're edited. How many times per performance is there a cutaway to show a judge reacting or discussing something with another judge? Dude. That's because I clicked through all 20 season winners and every single one won a recording contract with Universal, right? Like 5 have actually released records and only one was semi-successful on country music charts. Nearly every single American Idol winner has won 2 albums even if they didn't do well. It's a competition for 100K and they don't give a single shit if you release a damn thing after. Okay, I've watched a few episodes because I used to be a really big Total Drama fan, and may get back into the fandom soon actually, and it ... actually not that bad, targeted towards children obviously, but still kinda funny and manages to keep everyone as the same lovable and memorable characters they were before, just with the maturity level and imagination of literal toddlers. My 2 young brothers love that show and it has to be the worst thing I have ever watched. I could almost forgive the fact that there is basically no plot, since it is supposed to be a show for babies, but on top of that it's just a group of babies acting 10 times worse than Kalu ever did. Purposely breaking and ruining things in every scene is the only avenue of humor they even attempt at. Oh. And also there is an episode where an old guy dresses up as a gnome and halves all the baby's farts whilst moaning and going cross-eyed. While I do agree that the spin-offs aren't all that great, Comp Coral is awful, The Patrick Show is alright. Steven very likely knew about Comp Coral, it was announced soon after his death, so production had to have started sometime before he died. Or at least the idea was pitched. He probably approved it if that is the case. The Patrick Show, however, started production in 2020, almost 2 years after his death. So I do kind of agree with that one. Aside from that though, Nickelodeon is definitely milking this franchise to death. 2 movies after the first one, an entire musical, which is actually really great, so nothing bad to say about that one. The show getting rear ends more than any other show, with its only competitor being The Loud House, another show that is being milked to death and is going into seasonal rot, etc. SpongeBob is the reason why Nickelodeon has a mindset of if it's not as popular as SpongeBob, then it's going bye-bye and that's no good. SpongeBob these days has more to do with the more kid-friendly Ren and Stimpy than anything. It even has a lot of the same staff, though to be fair, the original era also did so as well and was still influenced. Honestly, seeing SpongeBob these days is like seeing a 90s alt rock group do very 80s hard rock in the 2020s. It's obviously the product of a very different time and stands out from every other kids' show. It's fine to keep the classics alive, but SpongeBob itself should have a break, even if it's very funny now and better than in the late 2000s. I didn't know about this when I saw the first new episode Fear of a Krabby Patty from season 4. It felt not entirely like SpongeBob. The episode was not totally garbage, but ever since I more and more lost interest in watching SpongeBob. I feel that with this episode, season SpongeBob began to be more and more disgusting and less funny. There was no fun in watching it, and finally I know why. I agree very much with you. The change in art direction and move to more gross-out humor got really apparent when Hillenburg wasn't around anymore. Though when he came back around season 9, things got a lot better. It's sad to watch how Nickelodeon is just flaying the corpse of this once great show, but I'm not really surprised. Also, I think it's really cool that you're an older guy who watched and fell in love with SpongeBob with your kids. I love seeing parents, especially dads, bond with their kids like that. I had the pleasure of getting really into SpongeBob with my dad as well. Pardon the ramble. I think I've got a SpongeBob plushie he got me somewhere downstairs. He even took me to a photo op with SpongeBob when I was in elementary school. I was just looking at that photo with him a few months ago. We stood out in the heat for quite a while, hahaha. I haven't watched TV much in the past 3 or 4 years, but he always liked watching it when it came on. He didn't hold that middle chunk of seasons in as poor regard as me, and it always put a smile on his face, and I'd watch it with him sometimes. We quite often referenced bits from the earlier years, like the infamous bit showcasing SpongeBob's brain in the episode about fine dining, so relatable and funny that it really stood the test of time for us. It was such a formative show for our bond and combined sense of humor. I'll always love it for that. I'll have to watch those old episodes sometime. He just very recently passed away. I am really struggling and missing him. He was my best friend. But thank you for this unintentional trip down memory lane. It makes me happy to think of someone else who got to bond with their parent over SpongeBob just like me. I'm quite sad, but right now, it's a happy sad, and I'm sure your kids treasure those memories with you too. Absolutely, positively this. The first 3 seasons of SpongeBob are some of the greatest shows of all time, animated or otherwise. So many are witty, intelligent, and wicked funny. Episodes like Grandma's Kisses and No Weenies Allowed are just 2 great examples right off the top of my head. Flawless. Hillenburg wanted the series to end after the first SpongeBob movie came out, but somehow he was overridden and the show continued without him. The plunge in quality and consistency is apparent from the start of season 4. Then the spin-offs came. My God. The destruction of Hillenburg's wonderful art is abhorrent to me. It's emblematic of what happens when true art is exploited only for money. I've heard that Nick makes billions annually from SpongeBob. It is disgusting. Oh, and for the record, I am a 55-year-old man. I watched and fell in love with SpongeBob with my 2 children when they were youngsters. They both had the good fortune to enjoy the first 3 seasons. The Patrick Star show looked like it was gonna be ass when I saw the ads. People pointed out how his parents looked totally different. Sister Sam isn't in it and got replaced with the squid character. I'm not sure if she's like an adoptive sister or what. And I personally saw that now Patrick has on a shirt and is fully clothed, lol. I know this one is a petty detail, but I wonder why a shirt was needed. No offense to Bill Fodgerback, but I hope the show flops and gets cancelled. I'm sure they wanted to make it new and different, but there are too many deviations from the actual SpongeBob universe. Seriously, what really irks me about Comp Coral is that young Sandy is in it and then the production crew realize the plot hole that creates and try to explain why she's there in the second episode, even though the episode where SpongeBob and Sandy meet is still canon in the main series. And with the Patrick Star show, I hate how Patrick's parents are completely different from the main series and that he has a younger squid sister. I've never watched SpongeBob, nor do I have an interest in doing so, but I just got an online petition about cancelling Comp Coral. It explains how the S.B's creator never wanted any spin-offs, and how Nickelodeon is ignoring his wishes since he died, etc. I generally never sign petitions for cancelling someone, something, super trivial stuff, or stuff I don't know about, but this is such a dick move on Nickelodeon's part. It pisses me off that they would disrespect the creator's wishes to make money he'll never see. What assholes. Ike if it's what Op is referring to, but there's a spin-off called Comp Coral that's all the characters as kids at a summer comp and some as counselors. Let's also point out the fact how this completely negates the events of the actual series, since most characters didn't meet as kids. There's also a Patrick spin-off that just started, straight up called The Patrick Star Show.